Welcome to everybody who's joining us today. My name is Chandradasa. Welcome. I am the director of the Buddhist Center Online, and we are hosting these conversations along with the BIPOC BAME monthly practice group led by Vimalasara and friends. Mine is the very pleasurable job of just introducing Vimalasara today, with whom it's been a delight to work on these events. I was thinking before I came on what I'd like to say about Vimalasara, because I get to do this every month at the moment. And today I thought I'd just rejoice in your generosity, Vimalasara, how much you've put into these events in the background, how much energy and love you've poured into them, and how much you've called on your friendships with people to put together a fantastic panel of guests to talk and have a courageous conversation around race. So I'm going to pass on to Vimalasara, and she's going to be your host for the next couple of hours. Hope everybody enjoys the conversation.
Thank you for that, Chandradasa. So firstly, I want to say welcome to all of you, and to all of you who have come to listen to this conversation, and welcome to all our panelists. And just to say that if you have anything to say, there's a tab that says panelist and a tab that says panelists and attendees. So if you could put all your comments in panelists and attendees. And if you have a question for us, there's a tab that says Q&A, and that's where you would write the question in the Q&A tab. So let me just take a pause. I just acknowledge some nervousness. I must admit, I went into a bit of codependency thinking, oh no, I hope it goes okay. So I'm just going to begin with a few words. I just really want to say that during this past week, I've really been feeling Bante in my heart. And those of you who don't know who Bante is, that's our root teacher here in Triratna Sangharachita. And I'm also just aware that when I look at this panel in front of me, it's because of him that I'm in relationship with all of you here. Once upon a time, I would have taken one look at the majority of you on the panel and would have made all sorts of assumptions about your whiteness, and many of them most probably right. And those assumptions would have stopped me opening my heart to each and one of you. I wonder how many of you on this panel had a close relationship with a BIPOC BAME person in your childhood or adolescence. And for some of you, while you may have close friendships with people in India, how many close friendships do you have with BIPOC BAME people in the West? I mean close, where you listen to us and hear us talk about the racism we have experienced on the streets before we even enter your centers, where we have shared our broken hearts and our despair in terms of what is happening to black and brown bodies in the world. How many of you rang us up to see how we were doing during the George Floyd uprisings around the world? You may ask, how many white people do I have in my life who share their broken hearts? A lot. Too many, some of my black mates may say. I want to quote Bante here. Very few people know the real meaning of friendship. More often than not, there is too much emphasis on sentiment and too little on action. Metta is something that must be lived. I ask, what action is our predominantly white Sangha going to take? It's not enough to encourage BIPOC BAME people to come to our centres. We are living in times when this population is hurting. This population is angry. Trayford Pellerin shot dead 2 weeks ago in Louisiana. 2 days later, Jacob Blake shot 7 times in the back while entering his car with children sitting in seats. A few days later, Kyle Rittenhouse, a 17-year-old white kid walking around with an AK-47, and nobody kills him. Not one policeman bats an eyelid. They chuck water to him. given carte blanche to fire his gun and kill too many people. Let me remind all of us. 1998, Michael Jones cycling with friends with a water pistol, shot in the legs by the police. 2014, Tamir Rice, 12 years old, shot dead for waving a toy gun. 2014, John Crawford in Walmart picked up a BB gun. Video footage proves he was not waving anything around. Police shoot him dead. 2016, Tyra King, 13, allegedly pulling an air gun that shot pellets. The police kill him too. What did these kids have in common? They were all black. And this list is endless. This is telling us that systemic racism prevails consciously or unconsciously. It happens everywhere. How many of you are followed in stores? When I come home to the UK, I'm followed in stores. How many of you are questioned almost every time when you come back into the UK with a British passport? I'm questioned every time. I want you to know I stayed many years ago, even though when I had said hello to some Sangha members I bumped into on the street and they looked the other way. In the Buddhist centre we could talk, but on the streets, Sangha members didn't recognise me. I was just part of that black, scary mass. This new generation of BIPOC BAME people will not stay. They will not tolerate some of the racist things. That said, I have been sworn to oath not to mention some of the things that have been said over the past few years. These people who are staying are gritting their teeth. Many have not stayed. It's not enough to encourage BIPOC BAME peeps to our Sangha, because when they come, many will leave because they will not immediately see their reflections. Many of you stayed because it was so friendly. Not the case for many of us. We need to do the work, and part of the work is my dream. We urgently need more BIPOC BAME Order members, and one of the ways that is going to happen is by creating an intensive one-year online training program for those already in the ordination process and ordaining some en masse, so that we have BIPOC BAME Order members who will stand beside you and help with this transition. I end with the words of someone who changed my life, Bell Hooks. It comes from an article she wrote in Tricycle in 1994, Waking Up to Racism. We see the absence of people of colour in predominantly white Buddhist circles. We hear the silence of those voices. What will it take for individuals in those circles to seek an understanding of that absence which comes from within? So, thank you. We are going to begin this courageous conversation with an icebreaker. And I will begin with Maitrisara. Each panelist has a minute to answer this question. Maitrisara, why do we need to be courageous to have this conversation?
Hi, everybody. Well, as Vimalasara has so powerfully evoked, this topic is connected with great pain, and it's not harm I bear the brunt of. So knowing that I'm a conditioned being and I know I'm capable of making mistakes and saying insensitive things with regard to racial suffering, so making those mistakes risks compounding the pain of people of colour. So doing that in such a visible environment here is a bit daunting, but of not to say anything, not to contribute to the conversation seems to be full of problems as well. So I'm trying to be courageous in entering as skillfully as I can into this conversation.
Thank you. Subhuti, why do we need to be courageous to have this conversation?
I don't personally feel the need to be courageous. I need to be willing and to want a positive outcome. And I strongly do. I want to see an end to any discrimination, any kind of graded inequality, as Baba Saheb called it, Dr. Ambedkar called it. I want to see an end to that all over the world. And I especially want to see it an end to it within our Sangha. I want to see our Sangha as a place where differences are accepted and everybody feels happy and at home and welcome. I really want to see that. So I'm engaging in this conversation as a contribution, a small contribution to that end.
Thank you. Ratnadharini, why do we need to be courageous to have this conversation?
Thank you, Vimalasara. Well, when I was writing one of my letters to the order, the way I put it was that it's hard when there's a painful experience that has built up over a long time and you've been trying to express that and your sense is it either hasn't been heard or responded to or it's met with reaction, it's hard to keep raising the subject. And on the other side, I think it's very hard to listen to someone's experience of pain when there's a sense that you directly or indirectly have somehow been part of the cause for giving rise to that. So I think that's a difficult position to be in, and it requires a response without reaction and just with breathing and listening. And I hope we can do this together in our order.
Thank you. Upayadhi, why do we need to be courageous to have this conversation?
Hello, everyone. Just listening to you now, Vimalasara, it's really striking to me that whatever courage is required of me, it doesn't compare to the courage that is required to me living in the United States while being Black. So just keeping that in mind. Nonetheless, it requires courage of me because I have a lot of skin in the game in many different ways. And this is my Dharma family. So it really matters to me in that sense. And I'll just name it because we're talking about broken hearts and bodies. So this white body this morning got up and I had what the French would call un caca nerveux, a nervous shit, literally, right? So it's like my nervous system has been conditioned in a particular way and that's showing up. And my praxis is to say yes, despite that, with forbearance and fortitude. And what I have to really push against in my conditioning, and I'll just name this, is the way in which my, because it'll help me be more present, the way in which my gender condition coalesces and compounds my racial conditioning. And maybe I'll say more about that a bit later. Thank you.
Thank you. Ratnaguna, why do we need to be courageous to have this conversation?
When you asked, when you wrote to us, Vimalasara, you said this could be humorous. So what I was doing was reading this. I got this book, Lion Lessons, and there's me just there. You can see the little me there. So I suppose, like Subhuti, I don't really feel that I need very much courage to be here and talking to you all because you're all my brothers and sisters. You only need courage when there's danger, and I don't really see any danger. What's the worst that could happen? Worst that could happen is you all disagree with me. That's not very dangerous. Or you might think what I'm saying is a bad thing. That's not really dangerous either. I'm thinking of the people who speak up for the truth in really dangerous situations, such as in Hong Kong, Jimmy Lai speaking up against the CCP. His home has been firebombed twice. I'm thinking of Alexei Navalny from Russia, who, as we know, is in a German hospital at the moment, having been poisoned. He's a man of great courage. And of course, Malala in Pakistan, the young girl who was shot by the Taliban for speaking out about girls' education. So that really takes a lot of courage.
I'm going to stop. Okay, because we're just 1 minute, but thank you very much.
Okay.
Ratnaguna, thank you. Prasadachitta, why do we need to be courageous to have this conversation? We can't.
Well, I just had to turn my mic on. So there's a lot of fear and anger, and there's a lot of appropriate fear and anger from my perspective involved in this subject. And I think it's important to be, I think courage isn't a word I use, but I would say just have faith in the faith, shraddha, in the value of it. And, you know, it partly has to do with like what you were saying. You in the past would have a lot of presumptions about whiteness, and it takes courage to just accept that is the water we swim in, that we have presumptions about each other, and that we can receive those with grace when they're true and when they're not true. And that takes courage because there's so much fear and appropriate anger involved in this subject.
Thank you. Saraka, why do we need to be courageous to have this conversation?
Thanks, Vimalasara. Yeah, I think there is a need for courage, because participating in a conversation like this includes a call to change. So change to our minds and hearts, to our very selves, to our relations with each other, and change to our institutions. And I think dukkha, discomfort or suffering, is involved in this. It's in many ways, it's easier to turn away, you know, and come up with all kinds of reasons why we don't want to participate. You know, perhaps, you know, this isn't my issue, or I don't have anything to say on this, or it's all too complex, or I've done my bit already. All those kind of things can make us turn away. And then the other reason is that there is a lot of fear around in society at the moment. And sadly, I think that there are forces who are encouraging and promoting deep polarization rather than healing and courageous conversations. So I think, therefore, participating in a conversation like this is a radical act.
Thank you. Parami, why do we need to be courageous to have this conversation?
Thanks, Vimalasara, and everybody that's spoken. I'd like to acknowledge that I think the degree or the nature of the courage that I need to sit here and have this conversation is probably different from the courage that my Black or people of colour, BAME people have in entering these conversations. So I guess for me, the courage I need is to be willing to listen. You know, and I listened to you, Vimalasara, opening that, and I thought, whoa, straight in there, which I appreciated. And of course, it kind of, you know, it jolts, because hearing those stories, which I've read and I've heard, it does have an effect. And I think just to learn to sit and just be willing to hear those stories. And I think personally, I tend to want to make things better. And just acknowledging that that isn't what this is about, in a sense. It's not kind of making samsara better, but just being really open to allowing my heart to be touched by the courage that others are showing as well. So, yeah. Thank you. And thank you to our interpreters.
Yeah. Thank you to both Jemima and Anna for interpreting us today. And I just want to say that I'm holding that for some of you, it doesn't take courage to have this conversation, and also holding for some of you, it does take courage. And I think just something that Parami pointed out, that on the last panel, when it was all BME, BAME, BIPOC people, it took courage for all of us to have that conversation. So there in itself, that talks to a certain level of privilege. Yeah. so I can hold all of that, and I hope everybody else can hold all of that too. So each panelist has been asked to speak for 5 minutes, and we are going to begin with Maitrisara. Maitrisara worked in education and community learning around themes of equality, justice and the environment for 25 years. We were ordained together in India. That wasn't in her bio. She said she was ordained in India and in 2005 and is inspired by the internationality of the order. For many years, she was involved in socially engaged Buddhist projects and organizations, finding ways for the Dharma to express its wisdom within the challenges facing society. She currently leads a service on behalf of the Birmingham Buddhist Center, offering mental health support for carers, a very culturally diverse project. She's Women's Mitra Convener, and she's from Wales and loves to sing. Over to Maitrisara.
Thank you, Vimalasara. So reflecting on being white, I recognised as quite a young woman that I'd taken on something unhelpful. You could call it an ideology of whiteness, a delusion of being white as an unquestioned norm, a kind of conceit. I obviously didn't choose to be conditioned in this way by my family, the media, my school, the books I read, the films I watched, and in other infinite ways. But once I became aware of its influence, which I did in my 20s, I felt a responsibility to look at it and to understand and transform it. And to this day, I'm still trying to do that. And it feels like there's still a long way to go. So knowing that, I asked myself the question, how might I be contributing to a culture in the Sangha which doesn't include the diversity of people who could be here? A few years ago, a member of the Sangha, a person of colour, offered an illustration, an example that I've carried with me as a reminder ever since. So say I'm in a group or I'm teaching a class and I might be trying to explain the possible origin of a particular habit or attitude, and I refer to our Christian conditioning. So you do hear that sometimes. I'm sure I must have said it at some point. And then someone with a Sikh or Hindu or Muslim background may get a message that they're not included in how the collective of us is being defined. So without being aware of it, I'm communicating messages about the flavour of the Sangha, how the norm is defined. So those moments repeated in different ways by different people over time build up. And when it comes to making a decision to carry on going deeper with the Sangha, that sense of belonging may not be in place for a person of colour to make that decision to go deeper, maybe ask for ordination or something of greater intensity. And they have a different cultural heritage. So how do we bring awareness to this and create a truly open space for everybody? So one of the things most spiritually alive for me in the past few months has been being part of a white affinity group with other Buddhists. So I'll say a bit about that. A racial affinity group is one where people who share similar racial conditioning get together to look at the awareness that they can bring to that conditioning. And the point, the purpose is to end the pattern of racial harm. So this has been such tender and connecting work. There have been deep exploration of ethics, some profound practice of confession. It's been challenging and uncomfortable in some ways, but always in a way that's meant we were going beyond our own self-referential limitations. And my predominant experience is becoming freer of something I don't want to carry around in the world. Doing this work, I started to think in terms of needing to establish for myself another way to be in relationship to my ancestry, my heritage, to find a positive way to relate to my historical location, not based on the deluded and negative notion of whiteness. as a result, I've got into an exploration of my Welsh roots, as mentioned, and the history of that land, which has been rich and enjoyable. I want to say something about guilt and shame. So I, no anti-racist practitioner I've ever met or read about sets out with the intention of making white people feel bad about themselves. There has been some poor practice at times which left people with unhealthy guilt, and it really is a skilled process to facilitate this work well. I think it's a myth that it's the intention of anti-racist work to shame white people. And of course, unhelpful guilt does come up and it needs to be worked with. And white affinity groups are a good space in which to move beyond that, maybe to positive regret or hri. We really have some great Buddhist practices to work with this, and I'd love for us to be able to develop them and make a contribution to this work in society beyond Sangha. The ultimate aim is to create a healthy way that people of diverse cultural backgrounds can be together in dialogue and to create together a community where everyone can go beyond their limited definitions of self and other, and as Dada Rinpoche would say, live united.
Thank you. Thank you, Maitrisara. Just take a moment to pause. Our next speaker will be Subhuti. Subhuti was ordained in 1973 and played a central role in the establishment of the London Buddhist Centre, which opened in 1978. He is currently the president. He was involved in the establishment of Gukiloka, the men's retreat centre in Spain. He has also been chair of the College of Public Preceptors and was involved in the establishment of the men's ordination process in the United States. For the last 25 years, he's been involved in the growth of the Indian wing of the movement, currently spending 6 months a year working particularly closely with the men's ordination team. He also visits Hungary, which brings him into relationship with the Gypsy Buddhists of Eastern Europe. He has written a number of books on Buddhism, including The Buddhist Vision, Buddhism and Friendship, and Sangharakshita, A New Voice in the Buddhist Tradition. Over to you, Subhuti.
Thank you, Vimalasara. I should say that I do work with the women's ordination team in India as well. I work with the public preceptors. I was just very struck by your opening salvo, Vimalasara, and as you spoke about the incidents, the tragic incidents, I was immediately reconnected with the shock and horror of it, as I heard about particularly George Floyd's death, and then more recently the shooting in the back, Blake, horrific, and my strong sense of the pain and suffering in those incidents and what they're emblematic of, and of the tremendous release of pain and anger that came with that, not just in the States, but in this country too, in Britain too. And I want to just say that I acknowledge that, I hear that, I feel that, and to some extent I share in it. And I want to say that I deeply regret that this happens in our world, and feel a strong desire that I should make some small contribution to moving us beyond it. And I recognize that the whole of society is affected by racism. It's not just those who are, as it were, its victims, but everybody is affected by racism in society. It's it gives us an instability to society. It gives a sense of antagonism within society. It means that when we walk about, we do not feel as if we're part of the same community. And that is not a pleasant feeling. It affects everybody, even those who are racist in attitude, overtly racist, or even more subtly racist, or unconsciously racist, as we say. It affects everybody. So I think that it's important that we all recognize that there is that, or let me just say, I won't speak for anybody else. Others, I recognize the huge suffering that is directly caused. And I also recognize that I am affected by that racism because it breaks the community of which I'm part. Personally, I've had no experience or very little experience of discrimination directed to me. A little bit of class has been thrown at me, mainly in the movement, actually, and a little bit to do with my nation. The Glaswegians used to give me a hard time for being English. And once when I was in the States, I was subjected to a little bit of racist abuse. But none of it touched me. It didn't leave any mark on me, because my basic position in life is easy and comfortable. Nothing is obstructing me because of the accident of my birth. It's just nothing to do with me. I didn't choose it. It just happened to me. And so for me, I have to make an effort of imagination. It's not something that, as it were, is immediately there for me. I have to put myself in a different position. I have to do that with every interaction that I have. But when people are so experiencing their place in society so differently from mine, I have to make a special effort of imagination and a special effort of empathy. And then I have to try to introspect on that and try to see what it implies about me. And about my contribution to setting all that up. And my time is running out, so I'm going to have to just very quickly say, actually, the main thing which I wanted to say, which was that I've mainly learned to do that work, insofar as I've done it, through my going to India and being with people who are Dalits. Dalit in Hindi means oppressed or broken. So people who come from formerly considered untouchable castes and communities, and working with them and forming deep friendships with them, and coming to see Dr. Ambedkar's work and his contribution. And the one thing I really want to get across is I think Dr. Ambedkar's perspective gives us a Buddhist way of approaching these issues, both in terms of our inner work and of our outer work. So I'd like to sort of emphasize that. Dr. Ambedkar, I think, is the key for us to find a Buddhist way to approach these issues.
Thank you. Our next panelist is Ratnadharini. Ratnadharini has been involved with Triratna since 1979 and with the women's ordination process since the mid-90s. She became a preceptor in 2001 and is currently chair of the College of Public Preceptors and based at Adhisthana. She's inspired by the potential of communication and friendship to transcend differences and transform mental states, and has been engaged with an exploration of restorative process within Triratna. Over to you, Ratnadharini.
Thank you, Vimalasara. So just after listening to Subhuti, it was making me realize something that's been in the back of my mind is that quite often if I want to translate what I imagine it's likely to be for a person of color, trying to talk about this kind of area, the closest thing I've got to it is my experience as a woman, particularly in Triratna as a woman. There's been a certain amount of history and a certain amount of history in our culture, also in our order and movement, that has been hard to engage with. I don't think it's on the same level of difficulty, actually, as colour. But sometimes I touch back into that myself. And I was thinking that, so it's been interesting for me to find myself chair of the College of Public Preceptors. I still, as a woman, I'm a little bit surprised to find myself in that position. And I took on to write a monthly letter from my position as chair of the college, which is quite a commitment. And I came out of a solitary just after George Floyd had been murdered. And I knew that I would have to address this topic in my letter. And I knew there'd been a quite amount of polarized communication in the order about it. So I knew that sticking my head up above the parapet, I was likely to annoy people, probably different people for different reasons. So it was quite a hard letter to write. But I wanted to make the point that I thought that our practice of the Dharma is not just about meditation on a cushion. It's very much about transforming ourselves, transforming our mental states. It's very much in relation to other. It also involves developing a great sensitivity and responsiveness to other people. And also it goes hand in hand with compassion is not just a warm feeling or not just sharing in the suffering of others. Compassion really is the desire to alleviate suffering in others. And I think that's such a key thing for any Buddhist practitioner. So that does mean that as well as working on our own mental states, we're going to want to engage deeply with others. And if we want to stretch ourselves beyond our comfort zone, we need to be more and more able to make connections with everybody, regardless, anybody and everybody. And we need to be responsive. We need to be freed up so that we're less concerned about primarily ourselves and able to be responsive to all beings. So when I wrote my letter in June, I had a lot of very positive responses. And a month later, the issue was still there. Race was still, I'm glad to say, in a way, it was still a very, very significant topic on the world scene. So I wrote another letter, and that time I received, I think, 5 quite critical responses from order members. It's been interesting because I quite enjoy following people up one-to-one. So I was very keen to do that. And all the people who had written to me were willing to meet with me and talk. And all of the conversations were good. They were all very straightforward, connecting as an order member. But it was interesting to try to understand the concerns that were being voiced, which I didn't necessarily agree with. What I was hearing were things like, why has race suddenly become such an issue? This is a popularist thing, not a dharmic thing. Why is racism being singled out as a problem rather than other causes of suffering? A concern that looking at racism in particular actually creates more polarization within our society, and that it might encourage a grievance or victim culture. And shouldn't we just get on with practicing the Dharma? Isn't that the solution to everything? And I was also asked whether I thought I should resign, but that was retracted as soon as we had the conversation. So I found it very interesting to engage with these topics. I'm flagging these because it was an effort. It was challenging for me. It was useful for me to try to think through what was my response to these points and to really try to understand where the other person was coming from. As I say, they were good conversations. And one thing I came up with as a result of this is I was suggesting to people I was talking to think, why do you think people of colour are so upset about this issue at the moment? So that was the question I left my other order members with. So that's a question I keep coming back to. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ratnadharini. Our next panelist is Upayadhi. Upayadhi was born in France of American parents of Italian, Irish, and English descent. She grew up both in France and in the US. She began her journey in the Dharma in 2004 at the London Buddhist Centre. Currently, she lives on the unceded lands of the Lenape people, also known as New York City. Professionally, her background is in leadership development, training and coaching. Following the wake-up call of the 2016 election, Upayadhi went back to school at Union Theological Seminary of New York, one of the birthplaces of Black and womanist liberation theology in the US. She's majoring in Buddhism and interreligious engagement, as well as training in chaplaincy at the Jewish Theological Seminary across the street. Upayadhi was reborn in 2018. Is active in the Triratna Buddhist Community of Greater New York. Over to Upayadhi.
Thank you, Vimalasara. So I'd like to speak primarily to my friends here, whether I know you or not, who are white. And I'm just curious, when I say that, when I say white people or whiteness, what do you feel and where do you feel it in the body in particular? And when I say white supremacy, how does that land? And is there perhaps for some of us a kind of unpleasant Vedana experience, or maybe it's numbness, or maybe part of you is a bit checked out, or maybe there's a rush to the head and a lot of discursive activity already about me and views arising. I think what fascinates me in this is that those of us of European descent, our people invented this, we made this up, whiteness, along with all the other categories. And yet at the same time, it seems so hard to really own the karma vipaka. And what I mean by that is not over-identify with it, but really deeply take responsibility and understand how it has also caused us to be dehumanized so that others can be dehumanized to our benefit as a people. And one of the characteristics that I work with a lot in my own experience and in working with others is the way whiteness does not know itself and it does not want to be known. And it creates a world to make sure that it's not known. So to me, it really feels like Mara not wanting me to wake up. So I've been reflecting a lot recently about my role, my position as an upper caste white woman in the United States in our system of racial graded inequality. And I think Dr. Ambedkar really exemplified this deep understanding of the two truths of the conventional and the absolute, and that it was, of course, incredibly important and yet not enough to state that caste, like race, is a notion of mind. He also spent his whole life's work fighting for the protections needed for his people, still needed today, because caste, like race, is a matter of life and death for us, for some people. I think what's fascinating to me as well about Dr. Ambedkar is that he also really understood that nothing short of a radical conversion was required, and that this is so much deeper than a political struggle. And that's what I'm deeply interested in right now. And I don't need to be clear anyone to convert to Buddhism or to Triratna's particular expression of that. What really inspires me is the great conversion out of white supremacy and working with others, whatever their social location might be, whatever theology they root themselves in, together creating these contexts where we can get on our knees and suck the toxins out of the wound and be transformed internally, externally, and divest, disengage from what we have created, this white supremacist system. That's what moves me, this great conversion, which really leads me also to vow. And vow is something I think that Dr. Ambedkar deeply understood. So I hear Black Lives Matter as no more, no less than an expression of the great Bodhisattva vow, that no one is liberated until we are all liberated. I don't think the world has perhaps ever seen a more Buddhist slogan. So I'd like to say that we were made for these times. To me, Black Lives Matter is an affirmation of the first precept because, yes, life is king, and life has been denied to too many for too long. It's also an invitation into radical reimagination of our society. What happens if we re-architect our world with Black lives and all those who are the most marginalized at the very center? What happens? Just imagine that for a moment. White people have a lot of skin in the game and a lot of healing that can happen as a result of that. So I'm still inspired by the new society, but certainly not as a rarefied white middle-class lifestyle enclave, as sociologists have described it. I don't speak for all Gen Xers, but I know for myself that the new society will not have a single nucleus. It will be multiple and hybrid. That's why I'm in seminary, working shoulder to shoulder with others in love and forbearance and struggle to deconstruct and reconstruct our theologies in service of liberation, building the kinds of, thank you, I'll wrap, the kinds of spiritual interfaith friendships that have always been part and parcel and fueled great movements of transformation. And I'll just end with, what happens if we reimagine together Triratna with Black Lives Matter at the very heart of our Sangha? What happens when we bring the margin into the center or completely switch paradigms entirely and out of this who's in, who's out paradigm? Thank you for listening.
Thank you. Our next speaker panelist is Ratnaguna. Ratnaguna was ordained into the Triratna Buddhist Order in 1976 when he was 23 years old. He is currently involved in the Sikha project and is the author of The Art of Reflection and with Shraddhapa Great Faith Wisdom. Over to you, Ratnaguna.
Thank you. I said earlier, I didn't really feel I need any courage. I do need quite a lot of courage now because I disagree with quite a lot of what people have said. I'm sorry, I'm just going to have to say what I really think, and it's not going to go down very well, but never mind. To begin with, Vimalasara, you talked about the death of George Floyd and the death of many other Black men in America as a result of white or police killings. I don't know how much you know about police killing people in America, but I really don't think it's a racial issue. It's an issue of the police being trained. Many, many more white people get killed by the police in America, Black people. A lot of Hispanics get killed by the police, but you know, we never hear a white person getting killed by the police in America. We never hear about it. They just don't put it up. We just don't know. And so we get a very distorted impression of what's going on. I think there is a real problem with the police in America, but I don't think it's a racial problem. I think it's a problem of guns and so on. There's a lot more I could say about that. But I won't say any more about that right now. And Upayadhi, you spoke very well of Black Lives Matter and talked about them being a bodhisattva type activity. I'm afraid I just cannot agree with that. I'm sorry. Black Lives Matter are a political organization and they make it very clear what they want to do, which is defund the police. Get rid of the racism. They want to ground the nuclear family. It's all on the website in America. You can admit they don't hide that. The three founders referred to themselves as some trade artists. I really don't think we should have anything to do with the organisation Black Lives Matter. Of course, Black Lives Matter. Of course, they do. But I really don't think we should have much. What else? the term white supremacy used to be used only for the extreme white racists. It seems to be being used all over the place now. It seems like every white person is a white supremacist deep down, except they don't know it. I just don't believe that. I'm not a racist. I'd be very surprised if any white order member were a racist. I'd be very, very surprised indeed. In fact, I think if it were found that any white order member were a racist, I think that would be a case for suspension, if not expulsion. There's so much about contemporary anti-racism, which is influenced by Marxism, postmodernist thoughts, and so on, that I think we just have to be really, really careful of importing into our movement ideas which are antithetical to the Dharma. That's probably all I should say for now.
Thank you. Just to let you know that your sound is breaking up, so if you could, for some people, they may have been pleased that the sound was breaking up, actually, but your sound is breaking up, so if you could get that sorted out, Ratnaguna, that would be great, but thank you.
I will try.
Yeah. Pause. Prasadachitta is our next panelist. Prasadachitta discovered an affinity to Buddhist philosophy and practice in his late 20s, and shortly after began practicing at the San Francisco Buddhist Center. He was ordained at Gukiloka in 2011. Since then, he has become co-chair of San Francisco Buddhist Center. He now lives at Dharmadhara, a retreat center and community in rural Northern California. Over to you, Prasadachitta.
Thank you, Vimalasara. I've really appreciated a lot of what I've heard from everybody, and I'm going to try to, well, in a way, tailor what I have to say. For me, white supremacist culture in the United States is a very real thing, and it's not a fringe thing. Is something that runs through education, it runs through the police, it runs through my family. And I thought I would tell a little story to begin with, because I am a white male and I'm very privileged, but I also was also raised by a single mother, you know, which has a lot of stigma, and my father was a pretty severe drug addict, and I don't have any formal degree or education. So I can say the world has treated me incredibly well for my conditions, and sometimes I do wonder, you know, how much of that, I know a lot of it is because I'm white, but how much of it, you know. Things have turned out very well for me. Sometimes I just thought the world gave to me, like, oh, here I was in an urban area of San Francisco, and I just felt like things always just kind of worked out for me, and I was like, wow, this is great, you know. And here I am, you know. A lot of things could have gone really poorly for somebody like me. And my whiteness has a lot to do with that, I'm sure. When I was very young, maybe 13, I was not that young, but my mom moved me to Los Angeles. She was going to school full time, and she had moved me from one school to another a few times as a very awkward kind of hippie child. And she was trying to get me to a school that was more white. I had been gone through a series of schools that were majority people of color. Now, my mom didn't think of it that way. My mom would never do that. But everybody knows in the United States that a school with more white people is a better school. This is unquestioned. Everybody knows it. It's scientifically proven. Proven through statistics, if you ask people. Anyway, I ended up at a much wider school in Los Angeles after having moved from a rural area. And I was carrying a camera around, a very kind of old Nikon camera at the time in the mid 80s. And two older teenagers started crossing the street, and I saw a look in their eyes, and I certainly saw danger. I had been beaten up, and I was an awkward kid, so I think I kind of was a target. They tried to take my camera. I didn't really think they wanted my camera, you know. I saw what was happening. They're teenagers picking on me. But it turned quite severe. One of them punched me very hard, and I went to the ground, almost passing out, and kind of woke up being kicked in the ribs and just beaten. And a woman pulled up in a car and shouted at these two teenagers, you go beat on your own kind. Yeah. She got out of her car to help me. She was an adult. And these two older teenagers, you know, I was 13, they may have been 18 or so, left me there, and she came to help me. And at that moment, I was given a view. Like, I knew about racism, I knew about white supremacy, and I knew about the nature of the country I lived in because I'd been educated that way. I was raised in a lot of countercultural circles. So I knew, and part of me was kind of horrified by what this woman had just done. She had turned what could have just been a normal, in a sense, teenage interaction. I had been beaten up before. I had been picked on before in the rural areas by white people. But she turned this into something else. And maybe it was something else. Maybe I was being beat up because I was white. It's kind of beside the point. What she had done is brought a kind of toxic, white supremacist alchemy into the situation that kind of horrified me, really, truthfully. And I pushed her away and went on my way. And I tell that story because white supremacy is being taught on many levels all the time to people in the United States, subtly and not so subtly. And this, if you can imagine, my face being swollen, my ribs aching, this woman really coming to help me, but I couldn't be with her. And actually, I know that I don't have much time, but I'd really like to read a quote by Isabella Wilkerson about this. Is that all right? It's 1 minute.
Okay.
Looking beneath the history of one's country is like learning that alcoholism or depression runs in one's family, or that suicide has occurred more often than might be usual. You don't ball up in the corner with guilt or shame at these discoveries. You don't, if you are wise, forbid any mention of them. In fact, you do the opposite. You educate yourself. You talk to people who have been through it. You learn the consequences, the obstacles, the options, and the treatment. You pray over it and meditate over it. Then you take precautions to protect yourself and succeeding generations, and work to ensure that these things, whatever they are, don't happen again. Thank you.
Thank you. And before I introduce the next speaker, I have an apology to make. Somebody took exception to the joke that I made about saying perhaps some people may have been pleased that we couldn't hear all of Ratnaguna, and I take that on board. I will say that I found it incredibly difficult to listen to, and I slightly reacted and made a joke. It was said in humor, but I will take that on board. So I hope everyone who was upset by that can accept my apology. So let's move on to our next speaker. Saraka. Saraka was born in New Zealand into a strong Irish Catholic community. She became a political activist and campaigner at a young age and followed this through to become a trainer and researcher in the field of equality and trade unions. She moved to the UK in 1988, where she met the Dharma and was ordained in 2003. She's active in the London Sangha and is fascinated by the twin challenges of transforming self and world. And I was in chapter with Saraka. We go back a long way. Okay, over to you.
Thanks, Vimalasara. So I would like to talk about two main things. And I think that there are two truths that are powerfully present in any conversation about race. The first is that Black, Indigenous and people of colour are suffering. And their suffering includes a very specific racialized form of suffering. And the second truth is that our attitudes to race are a very, very important part of our conditioning for all of us and requires deep examination. So other people have talked about the Bodhisattva, have mentioned the Bodhisattva in different contexts. The Bodhisattva fully identifies with the sufferings of others, makes the sufferings of others their own. So if we as white people could really feel this level of connection with Black, Indigenous and people of colour, I think that the suffering that is racism would become as intolerable to us as it is to them. And our brothers and sisters in the Sangha, in our community, are speaking of their pain, not just of racism out there in society, but also within our Sanghas. And I'm hearing, you know, particularly picking up on some of the themes from the earlier conversation, I am picking up on two themes in particular. One is a sense of loneliness, and the other is a sense of great weariness. And you know, I was thinking about this, and the loneliness of so often being the only person of colour on retreat, at a class, on a team, in a study group, in a leadership position. And Vimalasara made a proposal in the last conversation, and she's highlighted it again tonight, that, you know, we perhaps consider putting on a one-year intensive ordination training for Black and minority ethnic mitras. And I just think, why not? Let's explore it, even if it may seem difficult, it might seem impractical, you know, there might be all kinds of objections, but let's at least explore it. It's a great suggestion, and it could really make a difference to our Sangharam community. And I think that it takes courage to ask for things. I recall Amaragita saying in the previous conversation that sometimes she hasn't expressed things or asked things, as she was afraid that if she was met with a lack of understanding or perhaps even hostility, her heart would be broken. So the other thing that I'm hearing is wariness of always having to explain or not sharing the full truth, not being able to share the fullness of experience due to a fear that we won't understand or we will dismiss. And I think that's what's meant by the term white fragility, that we're not really able to take in or to hear what's being said to us, that we might get upset, we might get offended, we might lose our temper or fall apart, or react with comments such as, but we all suffer, or I feel lonely too, or all lives matter, those kind of comments. Which brings me to the area of conditioning. And as Vimalasara said in the introduction, I was born into a strong Irish Catholic subculture in small town New Zealand, grew up in the 60s and 70s. And I was strongly conditioned to dislike the English and to distrust anyone who was a non-Catholic. That was my conditioning. But also my conditioning was that as part of the white majority in New Zealand, you know, we were led to believe that we were superior to the indigenous Māori population. We were encouraged to think of Māori people as being less intelligent and more inclined to criminality. So I imbibed those messages as a young child, along with other more benign but perhaps very patronising attitudes about needing to help Māori people. the Catholic Church even had a particular thing called the Māori missions. So I really feel that our work as white people is to work together to unpick our own conditioning, to deeply understand it and unpick it, and look at the ways in which this translates into the present, because the way it translates into the present allows for white supremacy, white privilege, and white advantage to persist. Thanks.
Thank you. So our final panelist is Parami. In 1977, as a young activist in her native Glasgow, Scotland, disillusioned with politics but looking for a way to change the world, Parami began to practice Buddhism with Triratna, then the FWBO. In 1978, she moved to London to deepen her engagement with the Dharma and the Triratna community and was ordained in 1980. In 1992, Parami moved to Spain and since then has been involved with Triratna in the Spanish-speaking world. Over the years, she has held a number of responsibilities within Triratna, most recently as one of the International Order conveners. These responsibilities have meant that she had the opportunity to experience Triratna within a variety of cultural contexts, something which she really values. Living again in Glasgow, Parami is enjoying involvement in various social action projects. Over to Parami.
Thank you, Vimalasara, and thank you everybody that's spoken. I actually almost feel like just saying what Saraka said and just leaving it there, because quite a lot of my notes and quite a lot of what I wanted to say will echo some of what we've just heard from Saraka. So like many of us, I was very shocked by the death of George Floyd, and there was something very visceral in my response to that, and it was to do with reading, well, it was to do with watching a little video of it, and the idea that somebody was gasping for breath for 8.5 minutes seemed to really impact me very strongly, because the breath is so personal to, well, life. So I decided I would do a meditation practice of the first 9 minutes of every meditation that I did for a while. I just did a breathing exercise and tried to imagine what it would feel like to be breathing for my life. And so it had a very strong effect on me, actually, and quite shocked me. And it started a bit of a train, obviously, of conversations, and, you know, that's something that was put onto, sorry, I feel slightly nervous, starting to have conversations and read conversations and hear people's thoughts and views and experiences was quite moving. And one of the things it made me think about was to start to explore my own conditioning, my own upbringing, and what I've carried into who you see now from then. So I also grew up not in New Zealand, in Glasgow, but an Irish Catholic family, and both my grandmothers were immigrants to Glasgow, one from Italy, one from Ireland. I grew up with my Irish granny, so I thought I was Irish, basically, in a certain kind of way. And I grew up in a very mixed area in Glasgow in the 50s and 60s, probably still to some extent. There's quite more sectarianism than overt racism. So I remember being spat at on my way to school. I remember getting tomato ketchup poured in my white school shirt because I was a Catholic. So I started thinking, what has that made of me? And actually what it's made of me is a kind of fighter. I think my response quite usually, if I'm faced with something that feels like a threat, is to stick my chin out, you know, put my fists together and find a way to fight it. And thinking over these last weeks about that, I realised that if I were black in America, that wouldn't be my response, or black in the UK, in London or somewhere. So that was quite an interesting thing to think of, that probably I wouldn't actually, when faced with danger, put my fists together and fight. Because the danger that I was facing was not a danger to my life necessarily, although it could feel like that sometimes. So that was one thing that occurred to me. And also, I grew up thinking, you know, in Scotland, you supported two football teams. One was Scotland and the other one was anybody playing against England. So I was quite pleased with myself when one year I realised I didn't mind England doing well in the World Cup. So I share these stories in a way not to say that I've suffered. That's not what I'm talking about. What I'm saying is that I've realised that I'm a product of my own conditioning and that we all carry such baggage from our conditioning. Some of that baggage gives us confidence and allows us to live in the world in a particular way, and some baggage works completely against that. So when I started the Dharma in Glasgow, and I think for me, I'm very grateful that I walked through the door of a Buddhist centre where I saw myself and heard myself reflected back. And I don't think I would have got involved if I don't know, maybe I wouldn't have got involved if I'd gone into a Buddhist centre in London. So I'm very grateful for that. And it also makes me aware of the absence of that when people of colour, Indigenous people, Black, Asian, minority ethnicities walk into our Buddhist centre and how they're not often reflected back to themselves. So I went to try and help do something about that. And I also just want to acknowledge that I heard Amarigita saying the thing about not wanting to get her heart broken. And actually, I felt my heart break listening to her. I've known Amarigita for years, and I consider her a friend. And, you know, I'm sorry I've never really instigated more conversations. So that's, in a way, I just wanted to share some things very personally rather than looking at kind of structural, because I think starting from the personal and moving outwards is probably how I can respond to the question. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you to each and every one of you. And I'm not going to say this is representative of the whole order, because it's just eight of you here. And the order is very big, but you do represent all of you, some of the views in the order. And I was struck by many things that were said. And when I was listening to Ratnadharini, and I was thinking, there's Ratnadharini, the chair of our college, speaks about race and somebody says you should resign. And I was thinking, so if they're saying that to Ratnadharini, what do you think people are saying to BAME or BIPOC people when we try and raise race in a Dharma context? Okay, so just for you to reflect on that. Secondly, it's my view, and I will own it as my view, but I do believe that if something that Ratnaguna said that if somebody was known to be racist, that there should be an expulsion. I think if that happened, there would only be Black Indigenous people of colour in the order. This is my view. And one of the reasons why I say this is that I have to acknowledge that I'm ableist, okay? That actually I oppress unconsciously and consciously people with disabilities. I benefit from a world that caters to me. You know, it's pretty unusual that actually we've got sign language interpreters, yeah? Which means that deaf people can't even have access to the Dharma. Okay, so for me, I was thinking, well, why? I don't want to be expelled for being ableist, and I wouldn't want to expel somebody for being racist. My question to all of you, and for a couple of you to answer this question, and we're going to have 2 minute limit of answering the question, is what happens to you when people say you are racist? Because this is going to happen when we have more BAME and BIPOC people coming into our community. What actually happens when somebody says you're racist? What happens? Who would like to answer this question? Okay, Upayadhi?
I say thank you. Thank you for showing me how my racism was showing up. And I try to listen really carefully and notice my reactivity. And I try to remember that Hri and Apatrapi are the great protectors, and that getting to know intimately my conditioning is a doorway to liberation. And I'm gladdened that I'm safe enough to be around so that people can actually point that out to me without defensiveness, even though defensiveness can be sometimes an immediate response, but we have our practice to be able to work with the reactive mind and the reactive body. So for me, it's a gift. That may also mean that I need to be expelled from the order very quickly. Maybe Ratnadharini and I could talk about that, because I get this feedback a lot. And I see it as a verb, not as a noun. It's a thing I do.
Okay, thank you. Ratnaguna, I see your mic has been turned on. Would you like to answer?
Yeah, thank you. I can't recall anybody ever calling me a racist, so it's a bit, I'll have to imagine what that would be like. If somebody, I don't know, do you want me to say how I'd feel or what I would say?
Both. You've got two.
Okay. I would say, no, I'm not a racist. And I don't think I'd feel very much about it. I would think, well, why would they think I'm a racist? I might even ask them, you know, what makes you think I'm a racist? What have I said or done that looks racist to you? So I'd be quite different from Upayadhi.
Thank you. Subhuti? Yeah.
Well, I would be interested and wonder if I could learn something about my experience and about their experience. And yes, I'd see it as an opportunity for engagement and see what came of it. Yes, so I think my, you know, depends which day of the week it is and which side of the bed I got out of, but on my better days, I think I would respond with interest and with an openness to learning something about myself that I didn't know.
Thank you. Maitrisara, I saw your hand go up. Yeah.
I think I try to remember that it might have been quite difficult for this person to come and say this, that there may be many others that would have found that, this person has taken the step. And I try to remind myself of that in the moment where I would be feeling a bit it would be hard to hear that, and I'd be trying to remind myself of that. And I heard someone say something very beautiful last week, which was that is it possible for us to cultivate the qualities where we can be the one who someone will bring a difficult conversation to? So how can we enable ourselves to be able to be someone else feels able to bring something difficult like that to? What kind of qualities would they be? Would it be non-reactivity? Would it be openness? Would it be listening? And how can we kind of make that more possible? Because I wonder if those kinds of things need to be said more often and maybe can't be because of the defensiveness or the anticipated upset that might cause. So how can we build that capacity in ourselves to hear that kind of challenge?
Okay. Before I move on to you, Parami, just a couple of things. If you want to ask a question, there's a Q&A tab. Also, I want to say that I really wish all of you who have responded right now, I really wish that that people had met me with what you have met me, because my experience in the order is not what you're reflecting back to me. My experience in the order, if I mention racism or white fragility, I'm told you're attacking me. Yeah, you're attacking me. Why are you being horrible to me? Okay, these are some of the things, even now in this context, when I'm having conversations with friends, yeah, because I know that the amygdala goes off. I really want you to drop into this. When somebody says, you're being racist, or you've got white fragility, something happens. It's almost as if it's the worst thing we could ever be accused of. So again, what happens when we say that you're being racist or you've got white fragility? Parami, then Ratnadharini.
Well, I'll just be very quick. I'd be horrified, if I'm honest. That would be my response. And I think I would want to defend myself and say, no, I'm not, and etc. And then I hope, and I think I probably would then be able to step back from that and respond with the curiosity that others have mentioned and really try and actually get into some kind of conversation. But I would be horrified, would be my initial response. And somebody did actually once point out to me, a question I'd asked somebody was, could have been heard as race, you know, it had racial undertones, which was definitely not what I meant. But I had to step back and think, why would they think that? And actually, it was quite a learning situation for me. So, yeah.
So, thank you. Ratnadharini.
Well, echoing Parami, really. I remember when the topic came up some decades ago, I think, at the LBC. So I don't think it was aimed at anyone in particular, but there was a general, I remember a general comment that the LBC was racist. That's the London Buddhist Centre. And I think general criticism is very hard to respond to, but also I remember I saw the LBC as, it was a centre I was associated with, and I was horrified and disbelieving. And we did then have a conversation among the few black people who were there at the time and the majority of the white people who were white. And that was when I discovered the whole topic of colour blindness, which I hadn't been aware of before. So it was a very, for me, it was a very informative discussion, although, as I say, it was a generalised point.
Okay, thank you. And I just want to say, I wouldn't want to expel anybody for being racist. I would want to come into dialogue. I mean, I'm married to a white person, okay? She has racism, okay? I was raised by white people. They had racism. Yeah, I wouldn't want to expel anybody. I'd want to be able to come into dialogue. And this is what we're doing, all, each and every one of us here on this panel, coming into dialogue. Ratnaguna.
Thank you. I just want to say that when I was talking about that, I said, first of all, suspend and then possibly expel. Obviously, you talk to people, you don't just get rid of them because you don't like their views and so on. Just want to make that point.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, let's move over to some questions here. I have a question here. I'm curious about how else white people are affected by racism beyond the first effect it has on the communities we are part of. I'll read that again. Does anybody want to ask that? I'm curious about how else white people are affected by racism beyond just the effect it has on the communities we are part of. Is there anybody who wants to speak to that question?
I don't really understand the question, to be honest.
Yeah, I stumbled on that. Actually, the person who wrote that, could you kind of explain it a bit more? But I have got a couple of hands waving, Subhuti and Upayadhi. Subhuti? Oh, yeah.
That's what I understand. I think it's a good question. And I think that a society in which racism is endemic is one in which there will be tension whenever one encounters people of the other race. And so that it will affect white people because they will experience a tension, a fear and so forth when they meet people from another race. So just to give one example, that when race is it's sort of embedded in the whole culture, then that means that all interactions between people of different races, although there is no such thing as race actually, but what are conceived, ideologized as races, will be one of tension and often of fear. So I think that one of the consequences of of graded inequality, and I see this very strongly in India, is that those who are in the privileged position are in a subliminal and often not so subliminal state of fear about the what's going on deeper down. So it affects people quite directly, although they may not be that aware of it.
Okay, just before you answer that, Saraka and Upayadhi, the person has explained it more. What other impacts can white people experience as a result of having conscious and or unconscious racism? Saraka.
I think that we're all hurt by racism. You know, we're all hurt in the way that Parami described when she, you know, read about or saw the killing of George Floyd. You know, we suffer from it too in seeing our black brothers and sisters suffer, but also we are lessened by racism if we don't really examine the privilege that we have, or the benefits, the advantages that we have. Because as Subhuti has, I think, rightly said, that then fear can enter in as we are afraid that those privileges might be taken away. You know, sometimes white people say things like, oh, that black person only got that job, or they only got that position because of tokenism. And I think that kind of view stems from fear, that we are going to lose somehow if black people are treated with fairness and respect. So I just think we're all kind of degraded and unable to really meet our full potential until we really confront this in ourselves as well as outside ourselves.
Thank you. Upayadhi?
Thanks for the question. I'll maybe share some examples of things that might not have already been said. In terms of structural racism and the way that irrigates our society, one of the consequences is because in our education system is so segregated, our housing system as well, it means that I haven't had a lot of opportunities, and you mentioned childhood earlier, Vimalasara, to form friendships with people of color. And that is an impoverishment, a spiritual impoverishment, if you will. I'm also part of patterns of dominant white culture, and there's consequences to that. So one example that I'm looking at in particular right now is in participating in dominant white culture, it replicates itself. And what it means is that my Buddhist community stays and remains predominantly white. And in that, actually, my understanding and my deepening of the Dharma is greatly limited. And I don't even see sometimes how my whiteness is showing up in my attempt to work with the Dharma and to understand it in a more embodied way. It also dislocates the body and the mind in my experience. It's very wired into my nervous system. And just to name personally, in my family, my grandfather was a member of the Ku Klux, my great-grandfather was a member of the Ku Klux Klan. And there's probably more. My people arrived 10 years after the first boat with enslaved Africans on this continent. And there's lots of intergenerational stuff that gets transmitted that is very deeply, deeply toxic.
Thank you. You just reminded me of something, Upayadhi, that actually in the US, that the police force, I'm sure you know, in many states grew out of the slave catchers. That's how the police force was formed in the US, from slave catchers. Yeah, okay. So I'm gonna move on to another question. This is a question that was asked last time, and so I want to ask the question, we have time. The council of my local Buddhist center in the UK has put a statement about the Black Lives Matter movement on its website. The statement is followed by links to Understanding White Privilege, Under Our Skin, and the main Black Lives Matter website and the 13th Amendment documentary film. Another local order member wrote to the council to say that they object to the statement, asking for it and the list of resources to be withdrawn or at least modified. They added, as a Buddhist center and a charity, we cannot be seen to be politically biased, whatever our own individual views are. And this statement certainly gives the impression to me, and I assume to others who may well read it, that we are. Do you think that this kind of public statement on a center's website is helpful? If so, do you consider that these specific resources are helpful? So that's the question. Do you think that this kind, whoops, it's gone now. Do you consider that these specific resources are useful? So that's the question. If anybody would like to respond to that, to responding to a Buddhist center putting Black Lives Matter material on their website, directing people to different things to look at. Do you think it's appropriate or not, is the question. Saraka.
Maybe a useful analogy here might be to think about the caste system in India. And I don't think this question or, you know, an analogous question would arise in our Indian context because it seems so well accepted there that, you know, that our Buddhist movement is part of opposing the caste system and campaigning for the upliftment of the Dalits. So I think that, you know, it's analogous to think about a similar sort of statement on our own websites here in the UK and in the US and so on. I think possibly it's not always wise to link to very specific organisations. I don't know the various groups that are mentioned in those specific links. But certainly, you know, I think if it's general education material so that people can read up about what's happening and the general campaign about Black Lives Matter, I think, you know, this is one of the burning issues of our time and we can't turn our heads away from it.
Thank you. Maitrisara?
I'm sorry, can I just address the situation in India, which Saraka mentioned?
Okay.
Because it's not quite correct that people in India are very, very careful about any public statement which links to any political situation. So there has been a debate recently in amongst Indian order members. I'm not a participant in that, but I was told about it, about how to respond to a spate of atrocities against Dalits that have been occurring during the lockdown. It's a big uptick in attacks on Dalits. So there was a debate about how to tackle this. And they're very, very sensitive to the borderline between a spiritual community and a political organization. And they were very, very careful. I think it's quite fair enough. And I think that's what they did in it, was make clear that any kind of discrimination of that sort is not... It is not acceptable from a Buddhist point of view, but they're very careful not to make any connection with any particular political grouping. It's a very sensitive issue in India.
Thank you.
And I think it's a very good example for us. I personally think, for instance, I thought Ratnadharini's first a letter was very, very good. And I thought the letter that the POC group from the LBC put out was very, very good. And I think that sort of statement is excellent and it needs to be done. But I think when you stray over the line into espousing particular organizations and recommending particular material, you need to be very careful about what you're doing, because of you don't always know what you're dealing with.
Thank you. Maitrisara.
Well, being involved in a large public centre, it's often on my mind how to speak to all sorts of horrendous, upsetting, distressing happenings in the world. And people come into the class often full of distress and searching for some sort of response from a Dharmic perspective. And I think if we were to not be able to have conversations about what the Dharma can offer to those kinds of issues, I think we would be rather it would be quite alienating, and we would feel quite divorced from people's day-to-day lives. In terms of putting it up on as a public statement, sometimes this is said that we can't do make certain statements because of being charities. I think it is quite good to go and actually check what the charity commissions say, because the restrictions aren't often quite as limiting as sometimes we assume them to be. So I think it's worth being clear about what the charity commission do and don't allow to happen. But also that we shouldn't assume that everyone feels the same way about issues, and to create a context for positive communication, which spans different points of view. I think all of that needs to be borne into account, taken into account.
Thank you. One last person on this comment, because I want to get one more question in. Ratnadharini, your hand went up. So.
Just to pick up on where Maitrisara left off, my understanding is that we've had a general understanding that I think is being talked about more recently and becoming clearer in the International Council, that we don't align with any one particular party or group in any particular way. Having said that, every centre is autonomous, so every centre can do what they like, but to the extent that they are linked in and connected with Triratna, there is a general policy that we wouldn't make any one alignment, partly because there may well be a range of views. It's very, very clear there's a range of views of people coming to our centres, but also because it would distort the Dharma. It would. It's very important that what we're presenting is not aligned with any one particular thing, because it can't be. It would be to limit. It would be to define the Dharma in a particular way. So there may well be things that are socially useful, but probably best not to actually align with them or post them. Certainly not just all ones that belong to one end of the spectrum.
Thank you. So one last question from what people have sent in. As white people, are we born racist because of our conditioning and past lives? Are we born racist because of the system we live in and therefore conditioned by? What work is there to be done to decondition? Who would like to speak on this? Prasadachitta?
Thank you. Depending on what sense you use, I think the answer, depending on the sense that Vimalasara has been saying, that yes, we are, I mean, I don't know about born, but very shortly, I won't really address the whole notion of past lives in this issue, but at least to say very shortly, we are white supremacists. And I wanted to speak briefly to the story that I told, which is to say that the woman who told these two people, these two teenagers, to just get off, like, she could have brought us together by saying, who are your parents? Where are you supposed to be? Do you know what I mean? Instead of basically dividing us. And that's what happens. And I just want to say that, like, that creates and reifies the whole race thing. And, you know, I can say that the beatings that I had gotten at other schools from white people sort of brought, in a way, brought me in. You know, like, I don't want to say, like, masculinity at a young age is a weird thing, but in a lot of ways it actually, kids beat each other up to become, to connect with each other. And I don't, you know, that's very odd, but it's true on many levels. And in this case, it was turned into something very different that was about separating us. And I just want to say that, like, opportunities are lost there. And that's what, so it's like, whether we're born racist or not is a funny question, but, like, it's definitely being reinforced at every level from early age. That's all.
Thank you. One other person who might like to respond on this, Subhuti.
But everybody's born into a particular situation, and we imbibe the mores and the cultural attitudes of the situation that we're born into. Everybody, and one of the consequences of being born into as a white person is that you're going to imbibe, in some ways, if you know, racism is used in such a broad way, I'm not sure exactly what sense people are deriving from it. But yes, you're going to assume some things just as a result of being born into this particular body in this particular situation at this particular time with these particular views around. It's true of everybody in the whole world. And we all have to make an effort to rise above that, is Bhante's whole discussion of group and individual and spiritual community, isn't it? So it's part of group conditioning, and it's particular, and it's under discussion at the moment because of it. Well, it needs to be. Its time has come to be under discussion, but it's part of a general phenomenon. You know, yeah.
Upayadhi, 30 seconds. Do you want to say something?
Yeah. Just quickly to add that to me, it's really a praxis. It's about praxis, just like meditation. And I think it's one of the great strengths of the Dharma is to actually really privilege orthopraxy, if you will, over orthodoxy. And I would be concerned that there would be a lot of energy and time spent on arguing about ideologies and having the right social analysis when actually this is about training. This is about unlearning certain habits and finding new ways of moving through the world with greater love, compassion, and inclusivity. Oh. So that would be what I would offer.
Thank you. So coming to the closing part, I'm going to ask the panelists the same question, a minute to answer. Simply, what next? Maitrisara, what next?
Three things. Listen, and then listen again to the bits that were too difficult to listen to the first time. Support what people of colour are trying to organise and initiate, and try to give one's resources to that without taking over or getting in the way. And thirdly, find somewhere where you can look at the conditioning that you have imbibed, and some context where you can do that in a space of compassion and humility.
Thank you. Subhuti, what next?
I think what is needed is awareness, clarity, and communication. So I would say, let's continue this conversation in many different ways. But actually, I really like the idea of a much more focused attack upon the issue, which is what you challenged us with at the beginning of Vimalasara, a one-year intensive course. Whether that will be enough, I don't know. But focusing on people of colour in order to try to bring them towards ordination. And I'd like to see that happen, and I'd be very happy to assist in any way if that was at all helpful.
Thank you. Ratnadharini, what next?
I rejoice in your ability to have vision, Vimalasara, in many ways, and We will be talking about this, your idea of how to move forward, how to encourage more people to deepen their practice of the Dharma in Triratna. We'll be looking at that in November and see what we can do. I'd also be really interested to know if some people with different views within the order would be up for having a discussion, a bit like Subhuti did with Suryagupta, but maybe people with definitely different views, and they could do a private Zoom debate. And if they felt it had gone well, they could share it with other people. So I'd quite like to see more discussion in that kind of way, if possible.
Thank you. Upayadhi, what next?
Following the taste of freedom, I just want to speak to the incredible joy and connection that can happen through this work. And of course, there's so much to be done, particularly at the institutional level, and that will take its time. This is long haul work to undo and reimagine together. But I really want to at least speak to the value of not waiting for that, but really getting with other people at a grassroots level and connecting and talking about this and forming racial affinity groups in particular, and really looking at this intersection between Dharma and anti-racism work, and it's just very enriching. And I know it's not easy. A lot of us are really isolated, or this is new to us, or we don't actually have a lot of friends of color in our lives that can give us cues. And I think that white people getting together doing this work has its place. It's not the only place, but it's an important place, particularly for confession and learning the skills of repair. And there's a website launching today that you can check out. It's a collective of friends forming called White Awareness is Revolutionary. You can go to awarenessisrevolutionary.com. We'll be putting more materials out there that people can use to just self-organize as they see fit. And I know so much work's already happening, so please contribute so we can find each other more easily.
Thank you. Ratnaguna, what next?
Are you sure you want me to speak?
Of course.
Joke. I think a lot more discussion is needed. Much of what's been said this evening I don't agree with, and I would like the chance to discuss with many of you. I'd be very happy to have one-to-one discussions, conversations, and I'd really like your idea, Ratnadharini. I think there's a whole other way of looking at this which we don't seem to be looking at. For instance, you might be surprised to know that for the last few months I've been really reading and listening to a lot of blacks from America and this country, and they don't all agree with what's been said this evening. And I think we really do need to listen to another way of looking at this whole thing.
Thank you. Prasadachitta, what next?
Awareness is revolutionary. I agree. I agree with what Upayadhi said, and especially in this context, white awareness, and that means to me helping each other know about history, helping each other understand and be aware of. It's like the elephant, you know. We're all blind and just trying to feel the part of it, and we have to talk to each other about it. And the more we do, we're going to see that it's an elephant and not a hose and a trunk and et cetera. So yeah, listen, educate, and organize.
Thank you. Saraka, what next?
Yeah, thank you so much, Vimalasara, for organizing this. I think we need to be prepared to engage both our intellects and our emotions in the deep work of understanding and transforming our white conditioning. So that's one thing. And I'd just like to, oh, well, the other thing as well is to know that this work is going to take time. It's going to go on for a very long time. And I wanted to finish actually with a quote from Ruth King, who wrote the wonderful book Mindful of Race. And she says that the racial suffering we're experiencing in the world today is the result of seeds that were planted in the past that are now blooming. So we can't change the fact that those seeds were planted. They simply blossom the racial consciousness of the past, revealing the power of our thoughts and actions. Now, with more wisdom and care, we can plant new seeds of well-being in the same soil of consciousness, which will make prior seeds of ignorance and harm more difficult to blossom. We may see such blooms in the next moment, in days, or in lifetimes. Thank you.
Thank you. Parami, what next?
Well, one of the principles of courageous conversations about race, reading around that, one of them was expect and accept non-closure. And I feel that's quite important to remember, that we're not going to resolve this issue in a day or a week. So I guess what's next is being willing to be in it for the long haul and not giving up and thinking we've done it. So it's time to sort of, you know, okay, I've had my conversation about race. So I'm willing to carry on. I'm interested in the idea of how we support people into our order, into the community in general and into the order. I don't want to jump to the conclusion of what that might look like, but I'd like to speak to and hear from and listen to people of colour in the ordination training process and see what would be helpful for them and try and help in whatever way I can. And just to end, I really want to end with Dr. Ambedkar again and the idea of that, you know, there's no liberation until we're all liberated. And I can only feel thrilled and joyful at the idea of liberation. So that's where I'll leave it. And thank you, Vimalasara. Thank you, everybody, for the conversation.
Thank you. I hear Subhuti's hand there very briefly, Subhuti.
Very sorry, I forgot to say something, which is actually the most important thing I wanted to say, which is I think that we should engage engage deeply with Dr. Ambedkar and his thought and his work. And also, I think we should engage in a dialogue there should be a dialogue with our brothers and sisters in India around these issues. They know a lot, which is really useful to us.
Thank you. Our brothers and sisters will be on the next panel from India. Mm. What I want to say is I want to share something with you that you won't be privy to. I spend some of my time in circles with Black, Indigenous, people of colour and BAME people. And one of the things they're working with is their internalised racism. So if I'm in circles with BIPOC BAME people who are acknowledging their internalised racism, how is it that you as white people, and I'm talking not just to the panel out there, think you don't have racism, okay? It's just a question, because this is what a lot of BIPOC BAME people have had to really work with, their own internalized racism. Yeah. So I just want to leave you with that reflection. So I also want to say a big thank you to our sign language interpreters, Jemima and Anna, who are doing this for a pittance. They're not even part of our community. So I'm really asking and encouraging you to give some dana to help us pay for this and also for the webinar, which costs money. So please do give generously. I'm just looking to see, my notes from Chandradasa, anything else I need to be mentioning? We do, as I say, our next final conversation in this series will be on September the 26th, which will be very diverse, from Mexico to Australia to New Zealand to Europe to India. And I just want to say a big thank you to each and every one of you. This conversation was for people to really just speak where they're at. And I really hope that this conversation is also used as a teaching tool, because I know the first one has been used as a teaching tool. And I think this is a really important teaching tool too. So I'm going to end in our traditional way of just reciting the transference of merit and self-surrender. May the merit gained in my acting thus, go to the alleviation of the suffering of all beings. My personality throughout my existences, yes, we have to give up our personality. My personality throughout my existences, my possessions and my merit in all three ways, I give up regard to myself for the benefit of all beings. Just as the earth and other elements are serviceable in many ways to the infinite number of beings inhabiting limitless space, so may I become that which maintains all beings situated throughout space, so long as all have not attained to peace. Thank you. Thank you all for listening. This is the end of the second Courageous Conversations about Race. May you all go well. Thank you.